And welcome to Saroshi classes. So let's start reading chapter number 3 of class 11 NCRT, that is Introduction to Indian Culture. And we are going to read third chapter, that is Art of the Mauryan Period. So before moving ahead, we have just missed some pictures or some figures. So let's have a look at these figures first. Like you will see here the dancing girl. So this is one of the best known artifacts from the Indus Valley. Is this approximately 4-inch high copper figure of a dancing girl. This is found in Mohenjo-daro, and this exquisite casting depicts a girl whose long hair is tied in a bun and bangles cover her left arm. A bracelet and an amulet or a bangle adorn her right arm, and a cowrie shell necklace is seen around her neck. Her right hand is on her hip and the left hand is clasped in the traditional Indian dance gesture. She has a large eyes and a flat nose, and this figure is full of expression and the bodily vigor and conveys a lot of information. Second, here you will see the bull. So this bronze figure of a bull from Mohenjo-daro deserves mentions, and the massiveness of the bull and the fury of the charge are eloquently expressed. Now the animal is shown standing with his head turned into a right hand with a cord around the neck. So this was about the bull. Next is the male torso. So we have seen beard men in the last chapter when we are discussing about the second chapter, and here you will see the male torso. So in this red sandstone figure there are sockets. Here you will see the socket holes in the neck and the shoulders for the attachment of the head and the arm, and the frontal posture of the torso has been consciously adopted, and the shoulders are well baked and the abdomen slightly prominent. So this was about the male torso, which is in the red sandstone. Then the next is the painted earthen jar. So here you will see this figure. So this painted earthen jar was found in the Mohenjo-daro, and this jar is made on a potter's wheel with a clay, and the shape was manipulated by the pressure of crafty fingers of the potter. After baking the clay model, it was painted with a black color. High polishing was done as a finishing touch, and the motifs are of vegetals and the geometric forms. Designs are simple but with a tendency towards abstraction. So here is the another figure, that is figure of the mother goddess. And the mother goddess figures are usually crude standing female figures adorned with a necklace hanging over a prominent breast and wearing a loincloth and a girdle and a fan shaped headdress. With a cup-like projection, here you will see cup-like projection on each side is a distinct decorative feature of the mother goddess figures of the Indus Valley, and the peeled eyes and baked nose of the figure are very crude, and the mouth is indicated by the slit. So this was about the figures of Indus found during the or craft found during the Indus Valley. Now here let's have a look at this map. This map shows us the Mauryan side. So let's have a look at these sides. So here is the map of India, and here are different sites during the Mauryan period. So here is the Lampaka, here is the Kandahar, then Mansehra, Shahbargi, then Taxila, then Kalsi, Topra, Bahapur, Meerut, Lumbini, Rampurwa, Laurya Aranj, then Pataliputra, then Kaushambi, Gujjara, Rupanath, Sanchi, Ujjain. Here is the Girnar, then here is the Panguria, then here is the Sopara, here is the Sanathi, then here is the Maski, Yeragudi, then here is the Brahmagiri. Here you will see the Dhauli and the Javagada, which is in the Kalinga. So these are the sites which were under the Mauryan Empire. So let's start reading now arts during this period, like that is Mauryan period. So 6th century BCE marks the beginning of the new religious and the social movements in the Gangetic Valley in the form of Buddhism and Jainism, which were part of the Shraman tradition. Both religions became popular as they opposed the Varna and the Jati system of Hindu religion. Remember, Buddhism and the Jainism both opposed the Varna and Jati system of Hindu religion. Now, Magadha emerged as a powerful kingdom and consolidated its control over the other regions. By the 4th century BCE, the Mauryas established their power, and by the 3rd century BCE, a large part of India was under the Mauryan control. So, Ashoka emerged as the most powerful king of the Mauryan dynasty, who patronized the Shraman tradition in the 3rd century BCE, and the religious practices had many dimensions and were not confined to just one particular mode of worship. Worship of the Yakshas and the Mother Goddess were prevalent during that time, so multiple forms of the worship existed. Nevertheless, Buddhism became the most popular social and religious movement. Yaksha worship was very popular before and after the advent of Buddhism, and it was assimilated in the Buddhism and the Jainism. So before moving forward, let's have a look at this figure. It is a pillar capital and the abacus with a stylized lotus. So here is the lotus, here is the shaft, here is the base, and here is the animal capital. So this is basically a Mauryan pillar. So let's read something about the pillar sculpture and the rocket architecture. Now let's read about pillars, sculptures and rocket architecture. So construction of stupas and viharas as a part of monastic establishment became a part of Buddhist tradition. However, in this period, apart from stupas and viharas, stone pillars, rocket caves and monumental figures, sculptures were carved at several places, and the tradition of constructing pillars is very old, and it may be observed that erection of pillars was prevalent in Achaemenian Empire as well. But the Mauryan pillars are different from the Achaemenian pillars, right? So the Mauryan pillars are rocket pillars, thus displaying the carver's skills, whereas the Achaemenian pillars are constructed in pieces by a mason. Now the stone pillars were erected all over the Mauryan Empire with inscriptions engraved on them, and the top portion of the pillar was carved with the capital figures like the bull or the lion or the elephant, etc. Here you will see the lions. So all the capital figures are vigorous and are carved standing on a square or a circular abacus. Abacuses are decorated with stylized lotuses. Some of existing pillars with capital figures were found at Basra, Bakhira, Lauria, Nandagar and Rampurwa, then Sankisa and Sarnath. Now, the Mauryan pillars capital found at Sarnath, popularly known as the Lion Capital, is the finest example of Mauryan sculptural tradition. So, it is also our national emblem, and it is carved with a considerable care, voluminous roaring lions figures firmly standing on a circular abacus, which is carved with the figures of a horse, a bull, a lion and an elephant in a vigorous movement, executed with a precision showing considerable mastery in the sculptural techniques. This pillar capital symbolizing the Dhamma Chakra Parivartana, that is the first sermon by Buddha, has become a standard symbol of this great historical event in the life of Buddha. Now the monumental images of Yaksha and Yakshini and the animal pillars, columns with the capital figures, rocket caves belonging to the 3rd century BCE have been found in different parts of India, and it shows the popularity of Yaksha worship and how it became part of figure representation in Buddhist and the China religion monuments. Now, the large statue of Yaksha and Yakshinis are found at many places like Patna, Vidisha, Mathura, etc. Now, these monumental images are most in the standing position, and one of the distinguishing elements in all these images is the polished surface, and the depiction of faces is in full round with the pronounced cheeks and the physiognomic detail. One of the finest examples is a Yakshini figure from Didarganj, Patna, which is tall and well built. So it shows sensitivity towards depicting the human physique, and the image has a polished surface. Now, the terracotta figurines. So terracotta figurines show a very different delineations of the body as compared to the sculptures, and the depiction of a monumental rock cut elephant at Dhauli in Orissa shows modeling in a round with the linear rhythm. It also has Ashokan rock edict. All these examples are remarkable in their execution of figure representations, and the rock cut cave carved at Barabar Hills near Gaya in Bihar is known as Lomas Rishi Cave. Remember these caves. The rock cut caves carved at Barabar Hills near Gaya in the Bihar are known as Lomas Rishi caves, and the facade of the cave is decorated with the semicircular Chaitya arch as the entrance. Now, the elephant frieze carved in high relief on the Chaitya arch shows considerable movement, and the interior hall of this cave is rectangular with a circular chamber at the back. Now, the entrance is located on the side wall of the hall, and the cave was patronized by Ashoka for the Ajivika sect. Now, the Lomas Rishi cave is an isolated example of this period, but many Buddhist caves of the subsequent periods were excavated in the eastern and the western India. So here you will see the image of the Yaksha at Parkham. Now, next is what happened is due to the popularity of Buddhism and Jainism, stupas and viharas were constructed on a large scale. However, there are also examples of a few Brahmical gods in the sculptural representations, and it is important to note that the stupas were constructed over the relics of Buddha at the Rajagraha, Vaishali, then Kapilavastu, Alakappa, Ramagrama, Vettadipa, Pava, Kushinagar, and Pipalvina. So the textual tradition also mentions construction of various other stupas on the relics of Buddha at several places, including Avanti and Gandhara, which are outside the Gangetic Valley. Now, stupa, vihara, and chaitya are part of Buddhist and the Jaina tradition. Wait for a while. Okay, so stupas and the viharas and chaitya are the part of Buddhist and the Jaina monastic complexes, but the largest number belong to the Buddhist religion. So there were these stupa, viharas, and chaitya were used by the Buddhist, also by the Jain monks, but the largest were belongs to Buddhist religion. So one of the best example of structure of Buddha in the 3rd century BCE is at Bairat in the Rajasthan, and it is a very grand stupa having a circular mound with a circumlocutory path, and the great stupa at Sanchi, which we are going to discuss later, was built with bricks during the time of Ashoka. Later, it was discovered with stone and many new additions were made. So, subsequently, many such stupas were constructed, which shows the popularity of Buddhism. From the 2nd century BCE onwards, what happened was we get many inscriptional evidences mentioning donors and at times their profession. So, the patterns of patronage has been a very collective one, and there are very few examples of royal patronage. Patrons range from Lady Devotee to Gahapati, and the king's donations by the guilds are also mentioned at several sites. However, there are very few inscriptions mentioning the names of the artisans, such as Kanha at Pitalkhora and his disciple Balaka at Kondane Caves. Artisans categories like stone carvers, goldsmiths, stone polishers, carpenters, etc. are also mentioned in the inscriptions, and the method of working okay, it's taking a bit time, so what happened? Just wait, it's not responding, so just wait for a second. Let's hope it get okay. Yes, it's working. Okay. Okay. So the working was collective in nature, and at times only a specific portion of the monument is said to have been patronized by a particular patron. Readers recorded their donations along with their place of origins, and in the subsequent century, stupas were elaborately built with certain additions like enclosing of the circumlocutory path, or we can say pradakshina path, with railings and sculptural decorations. And there were numerous stupas constructed earlier, but the expansion or the new additions were made in the 2nd century BCE. Now the stupa consists of a cylindrical drum and a circular anda with a harmika and a chhatra on the top, which remain consistent throughout with the minor variations and the changes in the shape and the size. So here you will see the image of stupa worship, which is at Bharuch. Here you will see, here is the stupa. Here are the figures who are worshipping this, and here are the another figure. So this is about the stupa. Now the stupa consists of cylindrical drum and the circular anda. So here you will see a cylindrical drum, and here is the circular anda with the harmika and the chhatra. So here is the harmika and here is the chhatra on the top, which remains consistent throughout the minor variations and the changes in the shape and size. So apart from the circumlocutory path, gateways were added, and thus with the elaborations in the stupa architecture, there was ample space for architects and sculptors to plan elaborations and to carve out images. Now during the early phase of Buddhism, Buddha is depicted symbolically. Remember, during the early phase of Buddhism, Buddha was depicted symbolically through the different symbols like footprints or stupas or lotus thrones or chakra, etc. So this indicates either simple worship or paying respect, or at times depicts the historization of events, and gradually narratives became a part of Buddhist tradition. Thus, events from the life of Buddha, the Jataka stories, were depicted on the railings and the tornas of the stupas. Remember, the events from the life of Buddha in the form of Jataka stories were depicted on the railings and the tornas of the stupa, and mainly synoptic narratives, continuous narratives and episodic narratives are used in the pictorial traditions, while events from the life of Buddha became an important theme. All the Buddhist monuments, the Jataka stories, also became equally important for sculptural decorations. And the main event associated with the Buddha's life, which were frequently depicted, were events related to the birth, renunciation, enlightenment, Dhammachakra Parivartana, and Mahaparinibbana, that is death. So among the Jataka stories that are frequently depicted are Chandata Jataka, Vidura Pandita Jataka, Ruru Jataka, Sibi Jataka, Vasantara Jataka, and the Shama Jataka. Okay, so the frequently depicted Jataka stories are Chandanta Jataka, remember Chandanta Jataka, then Vidura Pandita Jataka, then Ruru Jataka, then Sibi Jataka, then Vasantara Jataka, and then Shama Jataka. So with this, we have come to an end of this chapter. But before ending this, let's have a look at these images. So let's read it. Okay, so here in this picture, you will see a lion capital. So the lion capital discovered more than 100 years ago. Here you will see the lion capital, which is discovered more than 100 years ago, and this is at Sarnath. So this Sarnath is near Varanasi and is generally referred to as a Sarnath lion capital. And this is one of the finest example of sculpture from the Mauryan period, and this is built in the commemoration of the historical event of first sermon or the Dhamma Chakra Parivartana by the Buddha at Sarnath. The capital was built by Ashoka. Now the capital originally consisted of what? Capital originally consisted of 5 component parts, and these components are firstly shaft that we have seen. Shaft means pillar, you can say. So this shaft is broken in many parts now. The next is the lotus or the bell base. So here you will see a lotus or the bell base. Then drum. So here is the drum. So on the drum is, this drum is on the bell base with the 4 animals. So here are the 4 animals proceeding clockwise. Next is the fingers of 4 majestic adored lions. So these are the 4 lions and the crowning element. Dhamma Chakra, a large wheel, was also a part of this pillar. However, this wheel is lying in a broken condition and is displayed in the site museum at Sarnath. Now, the capital without the crowning wheel and the lotus base has been adopted as the national emblem of the independent India. Now, kept in the archaeological museum at Sarnath, the capital has 4 lions firmly seated back to back on a circular abacus. Now, the lion figures of the capital are very impressive and massive. Remember this, these lion figures are very impressive and the massive, and the monumentality of the image is easily noticeable. The facial musculature of the lions is very strong. Let's have a look at here. Here you will see the facial features of the lion are very strong, and the inverse lines of the lips and its subsequent effect of projections at the end of the lips shows the sculpture's observation for naturalistic depictions. Now these lions appears as if they have held their breath, and the lines of the mane are sharp and follow the convictions that were in practice during that time. So the surface of the sculpture is heavily polished, which is typical of Mauryan period, and their curly manes have protruding volumes. Here you will see their curly manes have protruding volumes. So the weight of the body of each lion is firmly shown by the stretch muscles, and these muscles are of the feet, and the abacus has the depiction of chakra, that is wheel, having 24 spokes. So here you will see this wheel having 24 spokes in all the 4 directions, and here you will see a bull, a horse, then there are elephants and a lion, and these are between each chakra. So these are the finely carved, and the motif of the chakra became significant as a representation of Dhamma Chakra in the entire Buddhist art is very important. Each animal figure, despite sticking to the surface, is voluminous, its posture creating movement in the circular abacus. Despite having limited space between each chakra, these animal figures display considerable command over the depiction of movement in the limited space, and the circular abacus is supported by inverted lotus capital. So here you will see this is the inverted lotus capital, and each petal of the lotus is sculpted keeping it keeping in mind its density. So here you will see the density, the thickness you can see here. So the lower portion has curved planes, neatly carved, and being a pillar image, it was conceived to be viewed from all the sides. Thus, there are no boundaries of fixed viewpoints. A lion capital has also been found at Sanchi, but is in a dilapidated condition, and the motifs of lion capital pillar continued even in the subsequent period. So we just saw something about the lion capital. Now let's have a look at the another figure. You can see the Didarganj Yakshini here. So this is the frontal view, here is the back view. So you can see, you can observe the carving and how the sculptor, you know, carved this sculpture. So another in the another view, next view, here you will see this image. Here you will see, here you can observe the hairstyle and hairs. And so here basically a life-size standing image of Yakshini holding a chauri. So here you will see this chauri. Chauri is nothing but a fly whisk from the Didarganj near modern Patna. Is also another good example of the sculptural tradition of Mauryan period, and this is kept in the Patna Museum. It is a tall, well-proportioned, freestanding sculpture in the round made in the sandstone with a polished surface, and the chauri is held in the right hand, whereas the left hand is broken. Now, the image shows sophistication in the treatment of form and the medium, and the sculpture's sensitivity towards the round muscular body is clearly visible. Now, the face has round fleshy cheeks, while the neck is relatively small in the proportion, and the eyes, nose, and the lips are sharp. Folds of the muscles are properly rendered. Here you will see the folds of the muscles. Now, the necklace beads are in the full round. Here you will see the necklace beads are in the full round. And these are hanging. You can see these are hangings to the belly, and the tightening of the garment around the belly creates the effect of bulgy belly, and the lower garment has been rendered with a great cure. Every fold of the garment on the leg is shown by the protruding line clinging to the legs, which also create a somewhat transparent effect, and the middle band of the garment falls till the feet. You can see here, let me just show you. So here you will see the garment. So this is the bottom part, and here you have seen the garment. So how you know, carefully it is carved. It is so beautiful, by the way. So the back is equally impressive, and the hair is tied into the knot. So here you will see the hair is tied into the knot. Here you will see the hair which were tied into the knot, and the back is bare, and drapery at the back covers both the legs, and the fly whisk in the right hand is shown with the incised lines continued on the back of the image. So with this we have come to an end of this chapter. Do subscribe to our channel for more such lectures, and do hit the like button. Do comment below, do mention if you want me to make specific videos, and do subscribe to our channel, and do share these with your friends, your colleagues, anybody you want to share the knowledge with. Thank you.